a couple of shout outs before we get going. We got happy birthday to Manchester Roller Derby's new wheeled order skater F5 Yak. And that comes from your friends here at Men's European Cup. Oh, we found a money spider. It's good luck. Put it on your hand. We're going to be rich.
We've got an official announcing table money spider here. Come along to get the action. I can't see a wristband. Get him turfed out. I'm not having any freeloaders in this competition.
We've got a two-way shout-out as well that's also come in to us. So we've got a shout-out from Selena Vile, wishing her husband, Lieutenant Dam, good luck. And he has also asked for a shout-out back to say hi to you at home. So the lovely Mrs. Dam there. Hope you're enjoying yourself this afternoon. Thank you very much for tuning in. Looks like we are very nearly ready to go. We're just getting the last bits of kit check underway. All right, the first rolling whistle has gone past, so now we will going to be getting ready to go on track. And it looks like we're going to be seeing number one, Dark Matter, lining up against 42, Lieutenant Dam. Speak of the devil. 5 second call ready to go. All right, first whistle down, underway. Lieutenant Dam pushing his way down on the outside, taken down by Moo. Number nine, he is out of bounds, so he needs to recycle. Swiss Army Mike pushing him back. Lead goes out to number one, Dark Matter. He's on the infield, so he does need to make sure he recycles and enters back on the track legally.
Dark Matter sees Lieutenant Dam break the pack there, just calls off the jam.
Very short jam for the first one of the game. What do you think it's going to shape up like today, Sven?
It's hard to say, but whatever it shapes up like today, in 7 days' time, these two teams will face each other again in some hilarious scheduling of New Wheeled Order playing Tyne and Fear, and then a week later, New Wheeled Order playing Tyne and Fear. But it looks like we've got Alien Isle jamming for New Wheeled Order against Dog for Tyne and Fear. Both hard against the wall, and I'm trying to get through. Tank just missionary blocking against Alien Isle. Dog goes for the outside, both into turn 1-2. Dog just got Darth Sebius, but he picks up Lee Jammer. Alien Isle right behind him, though, as we see Barnabash off the track now. First penalty in the game to Tyne and Fear.
Quite a fast moving pack so far. They're making the Jammers do an awful lot of work to get around. Some hard hits up at the front there. Gay Fawkes making his way through, breaking up the pack there. Still coasting the Jammers through turn two there. Dog's keeping an eye on what's going on behind him. Going to be seeing some Jammer on Jammer action going here. Alien L just heading, letting Dog head out in front of him just a little bit to keep an eye on what's going on. But they're moving around about the same pace as the pack at the minute, starting to pick up now. Alien Al taken down at the back of the pack. No points scored in that last jam. So just 3 minutes in, no points on the board yet. We're going to be seeing Lieutenant Dam lining up against 60 Quad Bit. New Wheeled Order playing in the white shirts and Tyne and Fear playing in the black shirts. Seen an awful lot of teams playing in the black and yellow this weekend, so we need to make sure that we don't get too mixed up.
Both Jammers off the line now. 60 Quad Bit just against a hard wall of Don Gingivani and Crash Matt. Lieutenant Dam just bowls over Bob Orm, pushed to the front. Looks like we've got a forearms penalty for Lieutenant Dam and an insubordination. Failure to leave the track, I'll suspect. So that's going to see a 1 minute penalty for Lieutenant Dam.
We see he's been joined in the box by Moo. And we've also got Don Gingivani making his way around. A power jam situation now for 60 Quad Bit, but he's not lead jammer, so it looks like we're going to be running for the full 2 minutes.
Let's see if we can actually get some points on the board here for one of the teams. 60 Quad Bit through his first pass. That's going to be the 5 points. So there we go. We've actually got some points on the board now for Tyne and Fear. Crash Match has been held behind the wall of Chemical and Bob Om. Rash Matt picks up the forearms. You've probably heard that on the feed. Glenn Morangri is shouting. In fact, you've probably heard that at home.
He's one of the loudest referees I've ever met. But it's good, though. It means you don't have to... you don't ever wonder what's going on with his calls. Another 5 points on the board there for 60 quad bit as he comes round, and it looks like we've got two XL Hugo Boss who is going off for a cut track penalty.
So a severely depleted new wheeled order lineup now as reanimated Giff just does a great job just clearing the wall for 60 quad bit to step through on turn four.
Lieutenant Dam now back on the track, taking on against reanimated Giff and Kemikal up at the front of the pack there. Not managing to keep him down though. Oh, he is down on the infield. He's got a wall up against them.
You've got to feel sorry for any jammer that has to face Kemikal and reanimated Giff to the Team England blockers. And of course, reanimated Giff did pick up all tournament best blocker at the Men's World Cup earlier this year.
Dubbed the best blocker in the world. You've got to think there's quite a lot to live up to with that title.
He was so modest after that. He hated the fact that he got given that because he didn't think he deserved it. But I think everyone else in the whole arena thought he deserved it for the game he played, especially against the USA.
Yeah, it was a really epic game. And when you see, when you've got players like Moo and Al at the front of the pack, Kemikal that is, as well as Giff, that wall is just solid. And these guys, they know each other so well that they work tremendously well up at the front of the pack there.
Right, so we've got Swiss Army Mike up the line now against Alien Al. Swiss Army Mike takes the inside route as Alien Al is held back behind Gay Fawkes, Northern Woman and Barnabash.
Alien Al desperately trying to find a break in the wall with his feet there. He's trying to get his skates over the ankles of the other skaters, but not quite managing to do it. But he is out. It's not lead jammer.
Swiss Army Mike picked up lead. Darth Sebius picked up a multiplayer block on turn one as he was trying to hold up Swiss Army Mike.
Called it off and took a little flying knee.
Looks like it's 0 points.
So the scores as they stand with 24 minutes left on the period clock. New wheeled order still yet to put any points on the board. Time for you on 15.
And we've got Tintin now jamming up against Dark Matter. Again, we've got that blocking lineup of Kemikal reanimated GIF on for Tynan Fear. They've taken the back wall.
A favoured lineup for the blockers, especially when they think they're going to have a little bit of trouble from the jammers. With the jammers like Tintin, who can get really low and really exploit the gaps there.
Dark Matter there tried to skip the apex, dragged a foot, so he has to recycle right back into the end of turn one. Again, just being pushed right back. Lovely bridging by Don Gingivani and Hugo Boss. Ducks under Don Gingivani. Looks like we've got lead for Tintin. Both jammers out the pack at exactly the same time, but Tintin just a hair in front. Bin clears right on the whistles there, so more than women comes back the bin. So we're going to see a full 4-on-4 lineup.
I mean, there was a little bit of checking there with the jammer referees to say, is that right? But yeah, he was out just behind, but did manage to pick up lead.
It's always that horrible thing when you're a jam referee and you're next to the other jam referee, and both jammers break the pack at exactly the same time, and you have that little check with each other. And it's basically whichever one's out front calls lead. That's just the way it is.
Alright, Dog lining up against Alien Al, and the pack starting on the pivot line. Old school pivot line start.
Alien Al just trying to recycle Dog, but Dog having none of it, just waiting.
We've got Gay Fawkes is making his way to the penalty box.
Dog fighting his way through the middle. Alien Al takes the inside on one foot, picks up a lead for New World Order. New World Order, of course, still yet to get any points on the board in this stalemate of a game, really. 15 points only, and that was 60 quad bit in the 1 minute power jam.
Scooby Zoom trying to make sure he's keeping an eye on the pack from the front there to try and.
That should be 4 points for Alien Al. Yep, 4 points signal by Megalomaniac. So we have New World Order on the board now. Still low score considering it's 8 minutes into the game now. 15 to Tynan Fear, 4 to New World Order.
Alright, we're going to see 60 quad bit lining up the jam line for Tynan Fear, who are playing in the black jerseys, and Lieutenant Dam for Manchester Roller Derby's New World Order playing in the white jerseys.
Lieutenant Dam, of course, represented Ireland in the World Cup, so we've got a truly international lineup of players in all the teams this weekend, which is great to see.
Absolutely favouring the inside line. He's through for lead jammer. He's going to be happy about that. Looking now to up the score and lower that differential between the two. This could well be quite a low scoring game.
60 Quad Bridges having trouble there up against Slam C Nesbitt.
I think anybody would have trouble up against Slam C Nesbitt.
It looks as if, yes, Slam C Nesbitt, they're picking up a clockwise block on 60 Quad Bit right at the end. Looked like the block that put 60 Quad Bit down into the infield was clockwise, so we're going to see Slam C Nesbitt will be starting the next jam in the bin. So one blocker down for New World Order, Swiss Army Mike lining up against Tintin.
Nice solid white wall at the back there. We've got Scoob Zoom, Darth Sebius and Hugo Boss. They're certainly going to be looking at doing some decent breaking of the walls there to get Tintin through. But coming up at the back of Tank, he's certainly going to be having some trouble. Swiss Army Mike looks like he's off for a cut track penalty. So we're going to be seeing a power jam situation in favour of New World Order.
There's lead called for Tintin. Just as Swiss Army Mike takes his seat in the bins, that's 30 seconds from now, we start counting, folks. New World Order trying to slow this pack right down, but the no pack's forcing them to chase up to the preceding blockers of Tyne and Fear at the front.
Porky taking Tintin onto the inside there, so he needs to recycle, getting back in now, forcing through the front of the pack. Porky just skating backwards at the front there, up against Hugo Boss. If these two start to face off, that's going to be interesting. Through now, I'm picking up 5 points.
Tank just being held at the back now by Hugo Boss and Slam C Nesbitt, but with Darth Sebius as the third man in that blocking wall. Swiss Army Mike gets back to track, tries the apex jump, and landed inbounds. He's not going to pick up any points for that.
And Tintin was desperately looking for the team. Like, there was quite a big gap between the blockers at the front there from Tyne and Fear, but they closed it up very quickly, stopping him from getting anything else on the board in that last pass. Tyne and Fear on 15, New World Order on 12, just less than 19 and a half minutes left on the period clock. We're seeing Lieutenant Dam lining up against Dark Matter.
So it's an empty penalty box from the start of the game. Lieutenant Dam just going for the outside run. Chemical managed to fight off that advance, gets lead for New World Order.
Fantastic.
Dark Matter still being recycled at the back by Dungeon Giovanni, then pushed to the inside as he tries to take that line. Lieutenant Dam already through on his first scoring pass. Looks like he picked up the cut, so it's a power jam. Power jam, Tyne and Fear. Obviously at this point we don't know how many points Lieutenant Dam had already picked up on that pass. I think it was 3. We'll see when he returns and he gets his first scoring, that scoring pass completed.
Oh, Dark Matter taking a slight tumble there, but managed to stay on track. The absolutely formidable white wall there from New World Order.
So that's 5 points Dark Matter so far in the power jam. Comes up against Bereft. Number 9 Moo picks up a back block as he just tries to create a bit of space in that wall. Dark Matter pushed off.
Sausage Roller having a little hop on his toe stops after being knocked out by Chemical.
I don't know whether Dark Matter there was attempting to call it and realising that he wasn't lead, or whether he was just dusting himself off. Lieutenant Dam now back to track. Comes in the back of Giff, slides to the inside. Got Al facing him. Again, just avoids Al.
Dark Matter just recovering there from that. Oh, nice job.
Looks like Dark Matter's picked up the cut there when he tried to get across the apex. So now switch to a New Laura power jam. That's going to take us to the end of this jam.
I think it looks like when he went down, he was a little bit winded. Chemical's now going to be sitting down next to him for 30 seconds.
So Lieutenant Dam, power jam, New World Order. One less block, a Bob on with a great hit, just sending the outside. Dundin Gingivani goes for the revenge hit on Bob on to get clear the cut track, but gets the back block while doing so. Yep, 3 points it was for Lieutenant Dam. So 2 points Lieutenant Dam there, 3 points picked up at Dark Matter before he was sent off.
Dungeon Giovanni looks like he's having some issues with his knee pads. He was skating with the Velcro strap in his hand.
So although we've seen Lieutenant Dam on the jam line a couple of times, that was his first point. And this is the kind of close, hard-fought derby we expect from two of the top MRDA teams in Europe. And let's just say the Men's World Derby Association is proud to be backing this inaugural Men's European Cup. They wish all the teams competing the best of luck, and let's hope this continues for many more years. So back to the action. Ailey and Al jamming for New World Order. Has lead. Dark Matter is out the box and against Crash Matt and Hugo Boss. Gay Fawkes recycles Alien Al to the apex of turn 1-2. Chemicale is out the box now, so blocker advantage back to Titan and Fear as Barnabash is fighting Alien Al at the front. Alien Al side surfs the outside line on the rope. Dark Matter also using that outside rope just to keep himself in bounds to complete his initial pass.
Dark Matter looks like he's tiring a little bit coming back on the track there. Or maybe he's just faking.
Alien Al knocked to the inside. Soon he gets knocked in the inside and realizes he's going to be recycled into the oncoming path of Dark Matter, who just calls the jam. 2 points New World Order, so that's pushed New World Order into the lead. 32 to Titan of Fear's 23.
I think just a quick moment to mention Queens of the Sinbin, who are sponsoring the official merchandise of the Men's European Cup. They've also done the shirts of the Titan of Fear boys. And for all your custom derby clothing, whether you're a skater, official or fan, Queens of Sinbin can meet your demands. Go and visit them at queensofthesinbin.com.
Back on track, Tintin being held up behind Reanimated Gif and Moo at the back. Man-shaped dog being held up by Three Wall at the front. Looks like we've got some out of players on Sausage Roller. Man-shaped dog breaks past Bereft, picks up lead for Titan of Fear. Reanimated Gif still all over Tintin, and Darth Sebius comes into his aid and clears that threat. So Tintin out now and running for New World Order. No pack is called.
Gif is the only blocker holding that pack together at the minute from Titan of Fear.
Gif is going to be held on track until another blocker comes on track for Titan of Fear and a seat is available. So we've got Gif queued for the box. It looks like also Bereft there, I think, picked up an out of play penalty as we get some jammer on jammer.
And there's a noticeable head length of difference in height between these two. And Tintin has the slight advantage of hanging back a little bit and making Dog do the work and turning his head and being able to keep an eye on what's going on. More than a woman now on his way to the penalty box.
Looks like Dog was playing the time a bit there, just trying to clear the penalty box a bit, but obviously Moore going to sit down obviously undoes some of that good work. 7 point game, and we're 16 minutes in now to this first period.
New World Order on 36. Titan and Fear, who originally took the early lead, now on 29. Just under 14 minutes left in this period. We have a team timeout called by Titan and Fear. So they're going to be spending the next minute recouping just to have a little chat about what's going on. Talk about tactics, penalties, have a bit of a cuddle. All these things that you might find out happen in team timeouts. Referees on the inside having a chat. Cherry Fury calling them all in so that they could clear up a few issues, have a chat about stuff that's going on. We've seen a lot of action in and out of the penalty box over the last couple of jams.
Oh, it sounds like Ad Synth, one of the Titan and Fear players who's in the crowd at the moment, has got his drum out now, so...
I think one of the things that we certainly know with men's roller derby fans, they can certainly bring the noise.
So it looks as though we're just getting back in. It looks like the captains have been called in by Cherry Fury. They're having a bit of a word there, so maybe there's been some discussions among the refs, and Cherry Fury is having a bit of a chat with the captains and the benches. Probably just to clarify some is coming, or maybe issue some warnings. It's the kind of things that the head ref can do during the game. If they're seeing a lot of a certain type of penalty, you know, they may, or if they see kind of aggression levels rise, they'll sometimes just bring a bit of a calming influence to proceedings.
Absolutely. Sometimes it might be something that's been brought to their attention by one of the other benches. It could be something that, you know, one of the players has said, you know, I'm spotting a lot of this on track. I don't think it's getting called. Can we make sure the referees are keeping an eye out for it? They can take that as advisory. And, you know, obviously all the referees here all doing an absolutely fantastic job keeping everybody safe. and making sure that they play by the rules. That's what the rules are there for. In roller derby, not to be broken. And if you do, then it'll be 30 seconds at least in the penalty box.
Well, so we've got the 5 seconds calls. We're about ready to start again. Swiss Army Mike is going against Lieutenant Dan. Lieutenant Dan goes straight for the outside. Picks up a lead easily. Swiss Army Mike decides, I'll follow that, except Smack Bauer there waiting for him. He sidesteps Smack Bauer on apex of turn, the outside apex of turn one.
Okay, folks didn't manage Dan, to.
Sorry, Lieutenant Dan there just cuts on the outside, calls off the jam before it looks like. No, actually, there was some points. 1 point for Swiss Army Mike. 4 picked up by Lieutenant Dan there as he kind of pinwheeled around the outside of the pack on 1 foot.
So we're going to be seeing number 82 in the black jersey, Dog for Time and Fear, jamming against Alien Al, number 100. 5 second call, full force on the track. And, we just have more than a woman waiting to come in from the penalty box, so pivot down for Tyne and Fear.
Some Moo. Lovely hammer and nail blocking there from Kamikal and Moo.
Dog coming out for Tyne and Fear from Lee Jammer.
It looks like we're getting to find out that age-old question, what is more powerful, an Alien Al or a Kamikal?
We have to make sure we clarify which owl we're referring to. But it's not often we see Kemik Owl jamming these days.
No, he's very much a strong blocker. Obviously, the Tyne and Fear have got quite a strong jammer rotation anyway, so they can just keep Owl, keep his breath, keep him on track as a blocker.
All right, so we're going to see 60 quad bit lining up, and I think this is the first time we've seen Scooby zoomed on in the helmet cover for New Wheeled Order.
Yep, looks like New Wheeled Order are using a bit of a wider jammer rotation.
I think the instances that happens, you'll probably see your jammers on less. It could work to their advantage. You could end up with the jammers from Tyne and Fear wearing out a little bit quicker because they're on a higher rotation.
I have to also say at this point, I don't think I've seen 2 blocker walls as big as the ones we've got on track at the moment.
They are phenomenal. They're huge and they're solid. These guys aren't easy to get down. I think when you've got stature, that you've got Barnabash and Gay Fawkes as well, when those two are standing side by side, they don't let any cracks through. Shoulder to shoulder, they're going to make you work hard for that. Tyne and Fear picking up lead, 60 quad bit.
Hawkey just doing a great job there of recycling Scooby Zoom over and over. Scooby Zoom taking the helmet cover off. Looks like he's trying to fake the star pass. Gay Fawkes there pushes them out.
Then there was a call from Hawkey and Barnabash there that it was a track cut. It didn't look like it was. Obviously nothing was called. No hand signals at all.
60 quad bit picks up the 4 points, so we're down to a 2 point differential at the moment.
Peter Parkton making his way to the penalty box.
Barnabash has picked up a penalty there. I think it was an elbows that he picked up pushing Scooby Zoom to the outside. And Scooby Zoom comes up and hits Tank, but picks up the cut track as we go through. So we're going to see 60 quad bit on the power jam. He's got Crash Matt and Don Gingivani to beat so far.
3-on-3 in the pack, but that's not going to make much of a difference at the minute. 60 quad bit coming out. His lead pulls it off. They're going to be starting the next jam on a power jam.
And it looks like it's going to be, I'm waiting for the scoreboard to update, it's going to be 42-42.
10 minutes left on the period clock.
You can't get a very thin thing between these two teams at the moment. They're that close.
I think each of the games that we've seen today, at least especially the first two, we're so close up until this point as well, going into half time, that it's just happening throughout.
Swiss Army Mike pushing on the inside, just trying to get past Sausage Roller with Slam C as the supporting wall, but Swiss Army Mike picks up lead for Tyne and Fear. It looks like we're still power jam as Scooby Zoom standing. Barnabash returns from the bin, so now it's going to be all blockers on track, just Scooby Zoom missing. As I say, that Alien Al's going to the bin, so New Wheeled Order missing that block of Swiss Army Mike, just skips through the inside around Sausadora and Peter Parker.
The pack coming through turn three, so he's going to make some, he's going to do some work getting around on the track there. Moo and Chemical recycling him right around to the back, trying to get him off the track. He is off the track. They're not letting up for Scooby Zoom whatsoever.
Looks like Swiss Army Mike just faltered with his footing there, picks up the cut track, so we're going to go new wheel order, power jam. Scooby Zoom, of course, still on his initial pass right now.
They're not letting him through easily. Coming up against Reanimated GIF and Barnabash, certainly living up to his name there. Bashing him through, he's just bouncing off each of the Time Fear blockers. But he does absorb the hits very well. He's readjusting his pads as he comes through. But it doesn't seem to faze him too much because he's very focused and he just goes straight back at it.
Reanimated GIF picks up a high block there with the executor block against Scooby Zoom. So it's going to be three blockers only now trying to hold back this power jam, but those three blockers are Chemical, Moo and Barnabash. Again, that hammer and nail of Chemical and Moo. Chemical just setting it up and Moo knocking it down. Swiss Army Mike now back to the track, so power jam has ended. Scooby Zoom still stuck in the pack on his initial pass.
Being knocked to the outside yet again, being recycled behind Chemical and Moo. Chemical's trying to, he's favouring the outside line, trying to stay as close to the rope as he can, trying to force that cut track on the outside. He's knocking Scooby Zoom out as much as he absolutely can, but he's keeping him on. Alien L's going to be sitting for the next 30 seconds in the penalty box, so the next jam's going to start for New Wheeled Order with no pivot in play. Looks like we're going to be seeing number one, Dark Matter, in the black jersey for Time and Fear, lining up against Lieutenant Dam, number 42, in the white jersey. The scores as they stand so far, New Wheeled Order, 42, Time and Fear, 51 to Time and Fear. Just over 7 minutes left on the period clock.
Just something for you guys at home who are watching it on Twitter. If you want to send us, you know, who you think, because now you've seen all eight teams so far playing, if you want to send us who you think should be in the running for the best blocker, the best jammer, the MVP of the tournament, we're going to be looking at all those kind of things. We're going to be selecting those over the weekend. Those awards are going to be sponsored by Juice Wheels and Onwee Skate Gear, but Juice Wheels, of course, sponsoring the tournament awards. And Onwee Skate Gear, or Onwee Skate Gear, I should say, are also here showing off some of their new protection.
Smack Battle putting a huge hit on Dark Matter there, but he was recovering quite nicely. Coming through, just looks like he's having a leisurely skate as the pack is pretty stationary. I like how, it's funny how Gay Fawkes just stands, just looks like he's just standing there doing nothing. He has, looks like he's having a bit of a look around, but he's it's almost like he's secretly taking in what's going on.
Something, of course, that if you go back in the history, Gay Fawkes, of course, started out with Manchester Roller Derby before moving to Newcastle and joining Tyne and Fear. So obviously he's skated with a lot of these guys before, way back in the mists of time.
Back in the day. And Gay Fawkes as well, the other half of Team Gay Panda, one of our fellow announcers up here in Newcastle as well.
Now we've got finally got a decent gap in the score, 62 to 42. Someone will probably correct me, but I think this might be the biggest deficit we've seen in the game so far.
I think you might be right.
I'm getting a nod from Roller Polar Bear sitting here checking me facts.
I wouldn't even try and hazard a guess at anything mathematical at this point in time. It looks like we have an official timeout. Or is it a team timeout?
It's an official timeout. We've got our jam timer just doing the flexing at the front.
It's hard to see. We are looking straight down the jam line and pivot line down the straightaway. Obviously, the guys are already on track, so they're going to be waiting around to see what's going on. But just as we are getting going, we may as well have a shout out to skates.co.uk. They have been leaders in the extreme sports market since 2007 with a stellar range and expert advice in-house. You can't go wrong. Check out their website for the latest products and deals, skates.co.uk. So we've got just over 5 minutes left on the period clock. Do you reckon that 20-point deficit is going to be smaller or larger by the time we leave for half-time, Sven?
Well, the way this game's gone so far, who knows?
Who knows? There's been a bit of swapping and changing with the scores as we've been going along anyway. So
let's just hope whatever it is, it's some phenomenal derby action.
Absolutely.
Let's say that much.
That's all we want to see. And thank you guys for joining us at home today. Don't forget to use the hashtag MEC2014 on social media. Do send us a tweet. You might get a shout out if we can spot that you've given us something to shout out there. All right, looks like we are very nearly ready to go again. You're going to see Tintin lining up against Dog on the jammer line. It looks like there's an awful lot of people on the track because I think just some of these skaters, their stature is just amazing. Penalty box empty.
It's Tintin picks up lead as just Chemical gives him a last nudge just to save out the pack.
Chemical now, he's very aware of that 20-foot mark as he's coming out of the pack. I think something he's gained a better awareness of since the European Championships last year.
Dog just skipped past the block at the front of the pack there by Crash Matt to get him out. So Tintin gets in the middle of the pack, calls it off. Let's see what that goes. He got the 4 points on Tyne and Fear.
There was a bit of a draft up Al's skirt there. I certainly do hope he's wearing underwear.
Come on, let's please call it what it is. It's a kilt.
Sorry, kilt. He's gonna, if he hears this back, he's going to throttle me for saying that. It's patchwork quilt kilt.
It's utility kilt, I believe it is.
All right, we've got Donjin Giovanni lining up against 60 Quad Bit.
Very
massive wall
start
of blockers in front of him.
60 Quad Bit, of course, so thin that he can just slide between the arms of that new little wall. And he does so, picking up lead. Donjin Giovanni's got Porky in front of him. Porky just pushed him to the front, allowing Gay Fox and Barnabash now to get up in front and start blocking.
I think Porky in the same vein as Slam C Nesbitt, they don't have to do an awful lot. They just got to stand and look at you. And you could just fall over from that.
60 Quad Bit now up against Smack Bauer, and Slamsy Nesbitt controls that outside foot and breaks the pack for the first Grand Slam pass. Don Gingivani out of the pack now, so his initial pass completed as 60 Quad Bit is now coming to his second scoring pass. Skips in and he's calling as he does. It looks like possibly 2, maybe 3 points picked up.
Smack Bauer doing a great job through the pack there.
1.60 Quad Bit there on that second pass. Obviously, it's harder on our angle to see exactly how many hips they're passing. So 60 Quad Bit, 26 points so far in this game. So highest point score of a Tyne and Fear.
Right, so it looks like we've got Dark Matter on the jam line.
He's lining up against Tintin again. A very slow start. Bereft and Sausage Roller just jamming those hips together to stop Dark Matter through. Tintin takes the assault on Moo and Chemical. Moo just knocks him down on the floor. It's like Moo and Chemical have been working so well together as a twosome in this game. Mm-hmm. Chemical just using his amazing kind of backward skating to hold up the jammer, and Moo slides in. As we see Dark Matter slide on the outside, picks up lead for Tyne and Fear.
Chemical keeping an eye on what's going on at the front of the pack as Gif and Moo really start to boulder through the white walls. We're going to see Hugo Boss making his way to the penalty box. He's going to be sitting down 30 seconds off the track for him. Dos Sebius very nearly doing a one-footed pirouette on the inside there.
4 points picked up by Dark Matter there. Nothing for Tintin. I could just make out Big Smack and Fries, the bench manager of Tyne and Fear, shouting and call it.
Alright, looks like we're going to be seeing the next jam starting with the pack on the pivot line.
Let's party like it's 2010.
We've got 4-on-2 in the pack. Alien Al jamming up against Dog for Tyne and Fear. Ooh, some jammer-on-jammer action straight off the line.
Alien Al loses his footing as he goes around. He's got Barnabash.
Oh!
Alien Al has got the lead, though. He's got lead, so he passed Barnabash before Barnabash could get to him. Dog gets put down at the very back of the pack, so he's going to start his assault again on his initial pass.
It was a fantastic hit, but I think the fact that he got lead really spurred him on just to get up, and a nice little apex hop over on the inside there, picking up 5 points on that pass as he comes through. this could be the jam at which we see the difference made up.
Alien Al disagrees, calls off the jam as he sees Dog over his shoulder. So we're going to go now, slide in the last minute of this period. Score standing 72, Tyne and Fear, 51, New World Order. In a normal game, I would say, well, that's one jam, you know, a power jam. Mm. But in this game, I don't think that's the kind of thing we've been seeing so far. So let's pray for one of your derby miracles again, yeah?
Anything can happen, eh? Swiss Army Mike now jamming up against Tintin. A strong white wall that he's coming up through. Kazuka at the back trying to hold that down. They're not giving Swiss Army Mike an easy time of it at all. Coming up against Smack Bauer.
He's just stuck in the middle of the pack there. Darth Sevier, Smack Bauer, just holding him in place. I would like to use the term melee to describe that pack with Swiss Army just coming up against the front of Gazooka. Skips round, he's got Darth Sevius and Smack Bauer again. No pack is called, so they've got to release him. The ref just gets called out of play right at the end. There has to release Swiss Army Mike. So Swiss Army Mike with lead for Tyne and Fear.
A forearms penalty sending Swiss Army Mike to the penalty box. I don't think he knew what had happened there. He was like, what? He's just going to the penalty box, just shaking his head, not happy with that at all. Obviously, this is the bit that you were possibly preempted with the power jam, Sven.
Gazooka just trailing Barnabash behind him, taking him right back to the back of the engagement zone. Tintin's just pushing hard on Chemical at the front, but he gets knocked to the inside, starts that advance again. Smack Bauer trying to open a hole in the wall, but Tintin decides he's had enough, calls it off. That's going to take us to half time. So looks like there's 4 points going to go up on New World Order, so that should take us to 55 New World Order, 72 to Tyne and Fear.
Leading us into half time, a couple of things we want to mention. We've got the Blood and Thunder World Cup. The 2014 Roller Derby World Cup will be held in Dallas, Texas this December. We've got 30 countries, 4 days on 3 tracks. Get your tickets online. For more information, go to rollerderbyworldcup.com.
And obviously we'll see you there.
Yes.
You'll hear our dulcet tones over that weekend at some point.
Lucky you, eh? Okay, so we're going to be going into the next period. 55 points on the clock for New World Order and 72 for Tyne and Fear.
We will see you in about 40 minutes after these messages from our sponsors.
Okay, welcome back to the Men's European Cup 2014. You are here live with Panda and Sven. We're seeing Tyne and Fear take on Manchester Roller Derby's New World Order.
Yeah, we just seem like we've got a bit of action. I'm trying at the moment is Lincolnshire are just warming up, and I think we're going to get a visual kit check by the refs and our teams. We've got about a minute and a half before we come back to the official start time. So let's just have a quick, a few things we found out in the half time here. I mean, obviously, let's look at the schedule first. So this is the last game of our round one, as it is, really. So we know that later on today we've got game five. The one after this is Lincolnshire are going to be taking on Pan Am squad. And we already know the matchup of game seven, which is first thing tomorrow, which is going to be South Wales Sileos against the Quad Guards. So this game is pretty much going to decide which of these teams, so the winner of this, will go on to face Southern Discomfort tomorrow at 11 o'clock. And the loser of this will be playing last game today at 7 o'clock. That's GMT, of course, I must stress, at 7 o'clock Greenwich Mean Time. And they'll be playing against the Crash Test Brummies.
Absolutely, just a quick couple of messages from our sponsors before we get going. Rydell Skates, unmatched quality, unmatched performance. Check them out at www.rydellskates.com.
You'll notice, of course, if you look to the sin bin, on the next time you see the sin bin, there is a giant poster of Kamikaze Kitten there. That's because Rydell, of course, are our sin bin sponsors for this weekend. And looks like we're going to get back into the action now. Alien Al with a star on his head for New World Order. We've got Swiss Army Mike, of course, still in the bin.
Uh-huh. Starting on a power jam.
From previous period. And we've got 4-on-4 in the pack. Gift just immediately steps across at the path of Ian Al. Swiss Army Mike back on track now. So power jam in. Swiss Army Mike tries to do the inside, but that was bereft. Lovely little hip check, pushed up to the inside.
Swiss Army Mike pushing, still being knocked to the infield, needing to recycle. Struggling to get free there, but lead jammer goes to New World Order, Alien Al. Just breezing past his own blockers. They're keeping an eye on what's going on with Swiss Army Mike. Still yet to break through from that initial pass. Struggling through, Alien L picked up 5 points on that last pass.
Power jam, New World Order is Swiss picks up. Cut track now. So we're going to go start the power jam. We're going to go back to the power jam. Looks like there's an out of play block. Reanimated Gift picks up the out of play block. So 5 points for Alien Al on this power jam. Just trying to get the crowd whip up because this is going to bring our score even closer. Alien Al against Chemical again. Switch to try Bob on, but Chemical's still there. Chemical picks up the out of play block. Looks like Scooby Zoom also picked up an out of play
there. Yeah, it looks like he wasn't the only one. There was a couple of whistles there.
So that's who has done to the score. It's 70, New World Order, 72, Tyne and Fear.
Oh, this is going to be a close one.
For those of you who saw the first period, of course, you may notice that it looks like Lieutenant Dam isn't on the bench anymore for New World Order. From what we heard in the halftime period, I think he took a little bit of a knock to the ankle, so he's just basically taking himself out the rest of this game just to rest himself a bit. Mm-hmm. So if you're watching at home, Selena, don't worry. He's fine. He's just not going to partake in the second period to make sure his ankle is fine.
And if anybody else is watching from home, please do give us a shout on Twitter using the hashtag MEC2014. That's 2014. Quick shout out to Double Threat Skates, Roller Derby Skate Shop based in central London, run by the London Roller Girls. We've got Kristen Lee and Gorgasm there. Check them out at www.doublethreatskates.co.uk. I'm in an official timeout at the minute.
Let's just mention Queens of the Sinbin, of course. Queens of the Sinbin have been on board since the very start of this tournament and are our official merchandise sponsors.
We've all got some very swish gear
We've
from them today.
We've got some lovely t-shirts, and I see some of the announcers have already gone to work customising them. But yeah, so if you want some roller derby clothing, Queens of the Sinbin are the guys to get in touch with. Just go to queensofthesinbin.com, whether you're an official, a skater or a fan. Tintin in the first period, I'm just getting a note hand for me, picked up 19 of the points for New World Order. Let's see if you can build on that total now, jamming here. Swiss Army Mike, I'm guessing was an illegal re-entry. Mm-hmm. He's getting all of his penalties out the way in one go. But of course this isn't helping Tyna Fear. Barnabash with the shoulder just pushes Tintin to the inside. Tintin recycles back to the start of turn three.
3-on-3 on the pack. No opposition from Reanimated Gift there. He was not happy about that.
Chemical back to the track now, just fighting his way through the New World Order wall to try and rejoin his teammates at the front. Tintin gets hit off by Gear Forks. Recycles back as Darth Sebius clears Chemical. So we're going to see another power jam start. 2 points on the board for New World Order.
That's going to level things up. 27 minutes left of play in this second period. Scores 72 apiece. Still could be anybody's game. Alien Al jamming for the New World Order. Swiss Army Mike standing in the penalty box, so he's only going to be a couple of seconds before he's back on track, and hopefully no illegal re-entry this time.
Moo with a big hit again. It's that Moo Chemical truck trailer, or hammer and nail if you want to call it that. Alien Al attempted to start assault again on the four wall of Tyne and Fear. Swiss Army Mike beats Don Giovanni, tries to spin past Scooby Zoom but slides out, so he's going to be recycled again. Tintin being held at the front by Gift. Chemical just bracing as Swiss Army Mike gets knocked to the inside, slides the apex on his knees, and again recycled by Don Giovanni, who's going off now and bereft. lead opens up for Alien Al, so we finally get a lead as Swiss also breaks the pack on turn two.
He doesn't look particularly happy with the tussle that he had to deal with getting through the pack there. Swiss Army Mike, I think sometimes you can tell, you can see that frustrated look on his face. But as long as that turns into determination, that's going to keep us going. Alien Al has had lead five times.
Quite a good score rate. Obviously what the percentage is about, but obviously you need to be able to maximise or capitalise on that lead. You've got to get through the next pass and get the points.
Mm-hmm. Obviously the advantage of being the jammer is that you can call the jam off before the 2 minute conclusion. Dark Matter now jamming up against Tintin. Dark Matter firing out the front of the pack, picking up lead for Tide and Fear. Oh no, there was a penalty called. A high block penalty has been called, sending Dark Matter to the penalty box. So lead was open, but it's not been called because a cut track penalty sending Tintin to the penalty box. They're not going to be sitting for very long. It's going to be a second apiece, and they're going to be back on the track.
Well, we're going to get, because they both sat down between jams, we're going to get both jammers starting from the sin bin.
The jam was called off what looks like for an injury. So we're going to be having a look at the jammer on jammer sitting in the penalty box. Not jammer sitting on a jammer.
Obviously, both jammers in the box was what you mean.
Yeah. Obviously, you can't necessarily infer what I'm on about.
Obviously, we're seeing a high level of play here. And again, I said in the first period, it's exactly the kind of level of play you'd expect from these two teams. They've both risen up and got themselves to be full member leagues of the Men's World Derby Association. Mm-hmm. And obviously, the Men's World Derby Association are backing this event. It is the inaugural Men's European Cup that MRD are being involved in. They wish all the teams competing the best of luck. And let's see some of these European teams start the assault on the US, as we've seen the women's teams leading the way.
Speaking of women's teams, we do have the Blood and Thunder Roller Derby World Cup 2014 coming up in Dallas, Texas this December. 30 countries, 4 days, 3 tracks. Get your tickets online. For more information, do go and visit rollerderbyworldcup.com. You're going to be seeing a lot of the announcers representing here today are going to be travelling across. So, unfortunately, sorry, you're kind of stuck with us.
Just if anyone saw that last shot there, you may have seen a bunch of people sitting on a sofa on a riser. They are our VIP ticket winners, and that's their VIP zone. So they've got a comfy sofa, they've got a nice, big, thick rug, they've got a drinks cooler. And I want that next time I'm announcing.
It would be nice. We can just sit on there with the wireless microphones and just stick our feet up and chill.
No drinking though.
Not while we're working. Keep that for the after party. As you can see, the gigantic banner behind the penalty box there with Kamikaze Kitten on. Which leads quite nicely into mentioning Rydell Skates. Unmatched quality, unmatched performance. Check them out. www.rydellskates.com.
So I'm kind of looking forward to tomorrow now, seeing these, seeing this schedule that we've got so far. And again, the way that these teams are all playing this weekend, I don't think anything's really a cut and dry decision. Whichever of these teams advances to play a sudden discomfort, I think we're going to see a hard-fought game to push into the final stages.
Absolutely. I think, you know, regardless of what happens, there's no one league here that has come without the intention of pushing their way up the rankings in the European Roller Derby. It's going to work really well for a lot of teams, even if they're coming. You know, you might have some newer skaters. We've got leagues that Sven's already mentioned, they are part of the Men's Roller Derby Association, and others that are almost a part of that, still working their way up to it. But that's where you're aspiring to be, and like you say, pushing then into past the European market into worldwide roller derby, which is now getting recognised even on even more of a global scale, as we saw at the Men's World Cup earlier this year. We've got Argentina and Japan coming in and really surprising a lot of people there. And we do have a few of those, like you said earlier on, Sven, we've got a few of the different skaters skating for each of these teams here today that would have been in different teams across the World Cup. So you absolutely have a fantastic caliber of skaters here today. So we definitely, if you've got any of your favourite skaters that you know are playing here today, do give us a shout, let us know. Use the hashtag on Twitter, MEC2014. Do keep us up to date with anything. If you want a shout out, that we're here for that. Please do send us in any Instagram photos you want to stick on there as well, provided that it is PG, of course. Do please let us know. We'll give you a shout out as and when we can. In the meantime, we'll just have a quick mention to some of our other sponsors. We've got skates.co.uk. Need new wheels for your skates? Then check out skates.co.uk. All Derby wheels are currently sold with ABEC 9 bearings, absolutely free. You can't say fairer than that. Especially when you pay extra for your bearings sometimes. Absolutely fantastic. So, we are still waiting for the injury on track to get sorted. As you can see, we've got some shots of the teams and the crowds panning along. We've got an awful lot of teams in black and yellow colours this weekend. And got to make sure that we know who's who. And black and red as well. So you will see some different, obviously the leagues have come with different coloured shirts for different games. LRT, when they're playing later on today, they're going to be donning their purple shirts as opposed to the red ones that they were wearing earlier on. That's Lincolnshire Rolling Thunder, the Thunder Ducks. Pan Am were one of the teams in yellow that we've seen already today. The Crash Test Brummies. Tyne and Fear also play in yellow as well. They were wearing the black jerseys today. Scores as they stand, 72 apiece. 25 minutes of play left in this second period. So we're just getting some clarification on the assistance needed in-house. We have the down skater is going to be held out of the venue. So in the meantime, we are going to be just holding fire, keeping everybody all together. If you've got a few minutes, folks, do get yourself onto Twitter. Give us a shout out. Anytime I get I'll get the internet connection and Twitter loaded, I'll give you a shout out. So Sven has just taken a leave for a little while to give some assistance to what's going on in the venue, and the lovely roller polar bears join me here on the feed.
Rolly. I'm a bit of a roly poly bear, as you can see with my exterior. Interior full of custard and gravy.
Custard and grape, not all at once.
Yeah, I'm from Yorkshire.
All right, fair enough.
Custard and gravy is pretty much a dietary requirement for the Yorkshire people. And a good afternoon to everybody on the feed if you've had tuned in to Derby Duck. It is me, Roller Polar Bear, as Ben is away from the mic at the moment. And I'm sure we've seen some absolutely fantastic games. Start off this morning with LRT and SWS. Don't know about you, Panda, but that literally took every bit of my breath away.
That was an incredible game. I think a lot of people were sort of keeping an eye on Seuss before they came into the tournament because they were expecting great things. And coming out of that with the win, which was 227 to LRT's 209, That was touch and go. That was very similar to this game, I think, in the way that the scores were sort of inching ahead. But it was a considerably higher scoring game than what we're actually seeing here. We may well not even break into triple figures with this. We're going to see what's happening. There's very strong blocking going on, as I think we've seen throughout the tournament so far.
Yeah, indeed. It was, for me, I mean, I reffed at SWS about a good month, 2 months ago with Eddie and Human League. And they absolutely blew the Inhuman League out the water within the first 10 minutes. And from then on, they just carried on. They're a relentless team, a relentless team of big blockers. The Jammers are not a slight bunch. They are big, quite aggressive Jammers as well. And they will just keep at you all day. They will just keep hammering at you. They do not let up. And that proved today. And I think LRT fought a few times they were pulling away with that game. Mm. And every time just getting clawed back in by Seuss. And in the end, it was a fantastic win for them. LRT took the win very well as well. I thought they were fantastic losers in it, and they know they're pushing on now for a game a bit later against Pan Am. Mm-hmm. And there's still games to play for. There is, and there's a bit of kissing action going on the feed. Just see, he's happy. That's what he's come for.
Well, we've got, just as you mentioned there, the next game we are going to be seeing, game five, is going to be Lincolnshire Rolling Thunder versus Pan Am squad. What did you make of the French game?
I was actually very impressed with Pan Am. Mm-hmm. I played against Pan Am, and I've been very invested in how they've been progressing this last year, because they're absolutely one of the most nicest bunch of guys, and they are amazing at an after party, it has to be said. If you want to see a bunch of French guys set the tops off within 5 minutes of an after party starting, wow, those are the guys you need to. They've got the bodies. I haven't. And they absolutely were fantastic guys, and they've progressed this year, and I thought the positional blocking, their awareness, it just has gone up massively. Mm-hmm. The fact that they were missing key players like Pass and Painkiller DM and Mirage, I thought was a big tell for them. With 12 players on against the last year's winners of the Birmingham tournament,
absolutely,
to lose was always going to tell. But I think it was an 80-point spread in the end, or 82 if I'm right.
Somewhere about there, yeah.
I did think Pan Am were superb. And it's not it's not a locked-out game for LRT by any stretch, because Pan Am...
Absolutely. They're going to make them work. Just for the time being, we are going to go to some adverts. So here are some messages from our sponsors, and we'll be back very shortly.
Ta-da!
Okay, I'm here with South Wales side captain Neil Hilado. They played the first game this morning, which was a very, very close game, and on the ranks a little bit of an upset. They are beating Lincolnshire Rolling Thunder. How did you go about doing this today, Mr. Neil?
Well, with some difficulty, obviously. And we got a bit of luck as well, which I guess someone needed to have a bit of a break in that game, because it was, I think the teams are pretty close, maybe not rankings wise, but I think in terms of like the quality of the teams. And we kind of felt like their Jammers may have had the beating of our Jammers, if you look at them like player by player, but so we thought we've got to win it in the pack basically and just sort of stay really strong. So that's kind of how we did it, really. And the best we played in the game was the stuff when we were playing strong defensive walls and sort of like don't give Sully an inch on the inside or the outside. Yeah,
I spoke to a couple of the Lincolnshire players, and they were saying that they found you to be very disruptive in the pack. Had you specially trained any tactics for your pack work, or done anything specific in thinking about the fact that you were playing Lincoln first?
No, not particularly. No, we've just been trying to sort of hone our game, like our own identity of roller derby, really. So, like, that comes... The thing is with Sus, a lot of the time, we have to rein ourselves in, and that's what we're constantly doing. And when we can be really strong when we're playing just sort of tactical roller derby, and I think it's starting to show now. But, yeah.
You did get a reputation as a team of very, very powerful, aggressive blockers and jammers. And if you don't think, I mean, reining that in must have taken a lot of time and effort. Was the work spent mostly around the idea of being more controlled in the pack, or was it more about individual anger management?
They're both, I think, yeah. I kind of think we get tarred with that brush a little too much. Like, I think it's been like a couple of years since we've kind of been that team, other than like a couple of instances, and maybe some stuff that was attached to Team Wales, but... Yeah, I think we go into games and a lot of the time people think they're going to have a scrap, and then like at the moment we actually play roller derby, and they sometimes try and goad us into becoming the old Sus, and sometimes it happens, but yeah, I think we're beyond that now.
That's fantastic to see the further development and growth of the team. Looks like we're going to be going on for something else. It looks like it's going to be another interview, I believe, with Pan Am squad. Thank you very much, Neil Hilado.
Cheers.
Indeed. Good luck tomorrow in your game against Toulouse Quad Guards, I believe.
Yep.
Yeah, should be a very interesting game. Good luck, sir. So I think I'm going to be joined now by Pan Am. Now, I've had the pleasure of playing Pan Am before at the Men's European Roller Derby World Cup. Both Pan Am, I'm Captain Malice.
Hello.
Hello again, I believe. We played each other at the Men's European World Roller Derby World Championships, the European ones.
Yes.
We were opposing captains. And you were very polite and lovely the entire tournament.
Thank you.
You had a very interesting game against Toulouse earlier today, a game of two halves, very much. The first half definitely went your way, the second not so much. What happened in that second half?
Well, that's quite hard to say. What?
They tightened their game, very, very tough.
Exactly. They went really hard, starting to bring rhinos. I love that. And we lost a bit the focus at some point. So we tried our best, but I think they overwhelmed us a bit, just a bit.
Now I've been looking at your roster, and obviously I did play you before, and you seem to have a slightly different roster than before, and some newer skaters, and some I'm missing personally, such as Pass and and Painkiller DM. Oh, but Viking, the young man, he's diminutive. He didn't jam until you lost Maelstrom, and then he jammed. Were you saving him? Were you saving him for later?
No, it's not. We're not saving him, but he's jammer. But it was complicated to let him play in jammer because we know Toulouse. We know that they are big. They are not fat, but they are big. And and Viking is small. So
well, sometimes a small jammer can work against bigger walls, but.
Yeah,
yeah, it might be one to try him out against when you do play Lincoln later on today. Anything you're thinking, seeing how South Wales played against them, that you might want to try?
We didn't spend too much time looking at them, but what I've seen is it was a very interesting. It looks like a very interesting game, and very, very the score is very near, and so it must have been a very interesting match. Yeah.
Are you looking forward to playing them later on today, or is it going to be something you're looking at with maybe a little bit of fear and concern about?
For Lincolnshire, we never played them, so of course we are looking forward to it.
Oh, good.
We were afraid at the beginning to play again the same teams as last year, so it won't be the case, so that is really great. And. Well, yeah, it's going to be really interesting. I think we can do it, and we'll work for it.
All right, well, thank you very much, Pan Am Squad. Always a pleasure. I wish you all the best later on in the day. Have a good day. And we're going to... So now we're just going to be heading off to some adverts and some messages from our sponsors.
Hi, folks. Just to let you know, obviously, we've got a bit of a delay in the game here. We've got a player who's a bit injured. He's all stable, everything's fine. We're just going to get him checked out. We're just going to wait for some professional medical services to turn up and give him a full assessment. So we're just making him comfortable. Just to let you all know, if you are watching at home, all of this is going to be a bit of a delay. We are going to have every game today. The centre staff here, the venue staff are brilliantly going to stay open as long as we can to allow us to play every single game. So you're not going to miss any of the action. Just stick around, stay tuned, and we'll keep you an update as we go on. Right now, though, my colleague, Mr. Captain Malice over there, is going to give another one of his brilliant interviews to one of our Atom front runners, Sutton Impact. So I'll hand over to Malice.
Thank you, Sven. I am joined here by the lovely Mr. Sutton Impact.
Hi.
In his lovely, lovely Atom gear.
Game.
So you're an Atom front runner. Now tell me what that really does entail for you.
Well, Atom, they select women's is all-stars, men's is the front-runners, and we just try out all the new shiny stuff that they have, and we go around and, oh, I love it. It's just, we get stuff to try out. So at the moment, I'm just working on their new shiny gold pilots, which are, you know, it's a better quality of aluminium in them. They're lighter, stronger, lifetime guarantee, and I love them. Yeah.
So a lot of it is field testing roller derby equipment ahead of schedule. Fantastic. And I take it that's, you find it both beneficial to you as a skater and to your league?
I think it's one of those things that trying out these new things, like the new types of stoppers they've got, like the Bigfoot, which is very similar to some of the other ones now that have come out, where everyone wants these big ones where they've got the flat control. That's with the way in which men's derby is going with this whole back controller sort of 1 foot down. This is the sort of thing that people are looking for these days. I find that the ones where they got the curved part is less control and stuff like that. But there we go. I don't want to do any product placement stuff.
Well, not a need for any product placement, but you're here obviously with Sudden Discomfort. You won your first game quite comfortably against the Crash Test Brummies. And in the next round, you'll be facing the winner of New World Order and Tyne and Fear. Now, obviously, this game is currently on hold, but it is a tie game. I know you've played New World Order recently. I don't know when the last time you played Tyne and Fear. Do you have any preference about who you'll play next?
I think they're both strong teams. I mean, you can see by the fact that it's 72 all at this moment in time. So they are, I think New World Order have very strong walls. But then there's a little bit more jammer depth at the moment from Tyne and Fear. But it's a tricky one. We've played them both, I think, within the last year. We were in this place about a year ago playing Tyne and Fear. But this will be the first time that we've actually played either of them with our full team. We've always had struggled to have like our full jammer rotation coming in. So when we played New World Order in June, I think it was June? Yeah. We had one of our main jammer set, and when we played Tyne and Fear, we didn't have like Ballistic or Reaper as well. So it's one of these things now where I think we can truly show how good we are.
I was at that game, the New World Order versus Sudden Discomfort game. It was a very close, well, I say close. It's difficult for you because it was one where I think you may have struggled without that jammer, as it was much closer, within 100 points, which is a great result. But obviously, we've been talking a lot about rankings beforehand, and you've got your fingers crossed about something at the moment, haven't you?
Yes. Right now, we're trying to work out what's going on with the World Championships. So we're currently ranked 9th in the current rankings that came out in June, and the new rankings will be released in about 2 weeks' time. So we're 9th. The top 8 go to the World Championships. So we've got our fingers crossed. We did some good performances out in the US at Spring Roll, against like your mum and everything like that. So we played the top 4 teams in the MRDA and came out with good results. So we're now hoping that with what's happened in the last few weeks in other games for triangulation, that we should actually pop into that top 8th or even 7th place, which means we'll be in Seattle, I think it's the 18th and 19th of October, playing in the World Championships, which will be the first non-US team to make it into the World Championships. So that's good.
So you're looking forward to breaking some records for men's derby in the Europe?
I think it's one of those things that having an opportunity to do any first is an important thing. So the things we've had so far, both ourselves and New World Order were the first MRDA teams that weren't from the US as well, which is great. We were the first European team to actually tour at both either the Big O and Spring Roll as well. So that's great. And now, you know, we were the first team to win the Euros.
Well, you've done fantastic work here, and this is now your attempt to retake your European crown, as it were. Not the former, the championship before, but this is the Men's European Cup. Technically, you're here to, I suppose it's the similar sort of competition, similar level, but are you thinking you're confident you're going to win here?
We train hard. I think the experience that we've had from playing in the US as well, it broadens the strength and everything that we have within our team, because it's different styles and everything like that. So, you know, we had a good game against the Brummies. It was about a 10-1 score ratio, but I'm interested to see how Brummies play now against the other teams, because that's a good way of actually working out what's happening here, whether or not, you know, we are very far ahead, or whether or not the Brummies had a few, I think they were missing a couple of guys as well, and they had a few penalty problems. So.
It's interesting.
Everyone's had penalty problems today. Just finally, Mr. Sutton, one last question. Of all the teams here, other than Sudden Discomfort, who are you keeping your eye on as a single player at this time?
It's an interest. If you'd have asked me this morning, I think with a lot of other people, I would have said Lincoln. So I was shocked by that. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens. I think, so theoretically, it will be Sus versus Quad Guards.
It would be Seuss versus the Quad Guards, yeah, and the winners of this game will be facing yourselves. Yeah. So it could end up with you versus the Quad Guards again, or you versus Seuss.
I think the Quad Guards is the one we always have to look at, because they are, it is the classic European rivalry between the two of us. You know, we've, any European championship has always had us two in it.
They have been some very, very interesting finals, those games. Again, thank you very much, Mr. Sutton. Best of luck with the rest of the tournament. I've been Captain Malice. We are going to adverts, just being correctly told. So we'll be back to us from our sponsors. Okay, back with me, Captain Malice. I'm joined here by fan and skater, Argo, of the Barrow Infernos. Argo here, he's been here skating today. He's watching the skating today. Now, have you enjoyed the game so far?
Yeah, it's been really good, really good.
Yeah. You're recently coming off an injury, I believe a leg or ankle, was it?
Yeah, I broke my leg, the fib, two places. Yeah, playing Time of Fear.
Time of Fear?
Yeah.
I'm glad to see you're all right. Now, you've been skating with the Infernos since their inception, I believe.
Yeah, 18 months or so now, just over. Been bouting just over 12.
And you're just in the process of joining the MRDA at the moment, aren't you?
Yeah, we've got the applications in. That's as far as I know up to now. It's an association to be reckoned with, and to give the guys some credit for what we've done in the last 12 months.
Now, I've had a lot of experience either skating against you or announcing your games, and the growth of the Barrow Infernos, and in fact, all the roller derby in the Barrow area has been very, very impressive. The Furnace Firecrackers, the women's A18, they've come on leaps and bounds. You yourselves have been taking on stronger and stronger opponents, whereas, I believe, just over a year ago, the MRD B team narrowly beat you by 10 points. This recently was about 2 months back. New World Order you played against, and they beat you by just over 100 points. It's a much different set of games.
Oh yeah, most definitely. We've improved tactical-wise, skating-wise, We're all a rugby town where we have no natural skaters. We're all self-taught, coach-taught skaters. But it's improving big time.
Now, I understand that you're still the only league in Cumbria. Is that still correct?
It is. We are number one.
Now, I mean, have you been the key part of the growth? Has it all come in the same area? Do you get anyone from neighbouring towns or areas come to you for coaching advice?
Yeah, we have a few lads from Blackpool have come, skated with us. I had three, and now that are two. They're now a firm part of the Infernos, solid part of them. Our coaches do guest coaching, boot camps and stuff. And we have, like Hugo Boss from New World Order, he helps coaches our Ladies A team, who obviously passes it, transfers it through us as well.
So what's next for the Infernos? I know you've got the MRDA application in, but what have you got going on? What's your next game?
Next Sunday we've got the Inhuman League away to them. Blimey, put me on the spot.
You'll be playing Chaos Engine in the new year.
I'm actually playing Chaos Engine next month.
Oh, doing a little bit of guest skating, are we?
Oh, we have Time and Fear here away. We're the A team. We're playing them as well.
Let's look at this then. You had not a narrow loss, but not a whitewash against New World Order. And now you got another game against Time and Fear. Are you more confident for the game against Time and Fear with the added experience of what you got playing New World Order?
Oh yeah, most definitely. New World Order play a totally different game to us. It taught us laws. We played Rolling Thunder a few weeks back as well, Lincolnshire. Different gameplay as well. It's all more experience for us now. We're stepping up. I think we're 11th in Europe now, which is amazing. That our coaches and stuff and the players as well. But it will be a different game, and hopefully the Chaos rematch will be all right.
Well, thank you very much, Argo. I'll let you get back to the crowd. Have a good day. I'm now joined by Truck Rogers of the Crash Test Brummies and Team Wales. Let's not forget his Team Wales affiliation. Now, again, Truck, you had a interesting start to the day with the game against Southern Discomfort. I did definitely see you on the jam line quite a bit. How was it jamming against Southern Discomfort?
As is typical against jamming against Southern Discomfort, it's very, very hard. They're always going to be solid walls in front of you. You think, I can see a gap, I'm going to get through there, but then there's two more of them in front. It is like playing against a team similar to the USA when we were in the World Cup. They're just there in front of you. They're waterfalling and rotating around in front of you. So you get past them once, and there's one blocker left. All of a sudden, there's four blockers in front of you again. So it's just so hard. It's draining. It's sapping. But the relief and the pleasure you actually get from when you do break through, and you're looking back, and you're like, yeah, I'm through. I'm lead. Okay, let's go with this. And you're just rolling, rolling. You keep buzzing off the adrenaline, and really fantastic. Unfortunately, we had a really, really shaky start. SDRD put 90-odd points on the board,
95 points
before we responded. But, you know, we've come into the tournament quite late, replacing the Human League. And we feel like we're the underdogs. We know we're the underdogs. We're the lowest seed. So to have no expectations from us is quite relaxing for us as a team. So we're just coming here. We're going to play our game and see where that takes us. Every point we score gets a cheer. Every cheer makes us smile more inside, so it's kind of a nice little circle that we get going.
Well, that is the history of the Crash Test Premier League, is being the underdog. In the first European Championships, when it was seven teams, you were the ones, you know, you'd never played before, and you came in and went from strength to strength throughout that entire weekend. And are you hoping that the experiences gained here are going to help the Brummies propel on even further?
I hope so. This tournament in particular, we're blooding a few new guys, so I don't know whether you noticed, like Bruce. This is Carnage's first major tournament, and Mary. We got quite a few guys, and even Slam, the poor guy who got the nose issue early on. So hopefully, with them getting this experience, we can go back to training now and pull the experiences from this weekend, push forward, and we'll be ready for BOD come November. BOD, Brummies European Alternative Roller Derby Invitational, Cannock Chase Leisure Centre in November.
I'm impressed that you managed to remember that acronym in full. I always struggle with it. Now, obviously, you've experienced a lot of this skating with Team Wales, and now obviously skating in the Brummies. Is there any massive difference in the way the games are played at an international level to a team level?
I think it's very dependent on what kind of team you're playing. Obviously, if you're playing a newer team, someone new, say like Bristol, Milton Keynes, even though Milton Keynes are going from strength to strength, you play some of the newer teams. It feels like we were at the beginning. You just want to hit. You just want to hit. You just want to hit. But as time goes on and everything progresses, the tactics, the strategies become more involved. So the higher level tournaments like this, you're seeing more play, which is very similar to play you've already seen at the World Cup and on those scales. So in that respect, you have got the difference, but it's nice to see that the sport as a whole is evolving to compete with world-class level play.
Fantastic. Now, Truck, you're a jammer primarily, aren't you?
Primarily, yes.
Now, I've seen you block occasionally, but mostly I always see you as a jammer. Now, one thing I want to ask, I am not a jammer, I'm a blocker. And I look at those sudden discomfort walls that you fought your way through, and I look at them and just go, that just has to sap your will. Now, you said about the high you get when you get through. Is that what just keeps you pushing and pushing and going and going?
Yeah, it most certainly is. But I put a little post up on Facebook the other day, a little positive little, let's lift everybody up. And it was basically, I remember the first time I got given the jammer panty, and I just thought, I can't do this. I'm not good enough to do this. It was all very negative. I'm never going to be able to do this. My team are going to think I'm not very good, and I don't want to let the side down. But now it's, give me the thing, I'll rip it out of your hand, I will score points. But to see that change, to be able to go from, I was very negative to being very positive. So you take that into your game, and it's just a case of, it's just a wall. It doesn't matter that it's SDRD. Doesn't matter who it is in front of it, it's just four blokes. And all you've got to do is find the gap, concentrate on getting through, and trust in your team to help on the offence. So when I'm there on the jam line, it doesn't matter whether I've got Furia there, or Reaper, or Ballistic, I treat them exactly the same. And you just nice little dinky hit on the line, and try your best to get through.
Well, thank you very much, Truck.
It's a pleasure.
I wish you the best of luck later on today, or well, maybe tomorrow if we are held up even further. But good luck to the Brummies the rest of the tournament, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we'll be going back to the adverts again. I've been Captain Mars, and here's some messages from our sponsor. Okay, back with Captain Malice here, interviewing still at the European Cup. Joining me today, we have a lovely, lovely representative from the UK RDA. Please introduce yourself and tell me all about the UK RDA.
Hi, I'm Gareth. I'm the BRFG of Kent Roller Girls. I've been with UK RDA since October last year as a director. We exist to promote and grow roller derby in the UK.
Now, you have a big conference coming up called UROC.
UK Rock.
UK Rock. That works as well. Okay, so UK Rock is happening later this year, and there's going to be some important things for developing leagues and established leagues that may be very beneficial for them. What is going to be on offer at this conference?
Absolutely. There's going to be a lot of different threads happening concurrently. We have officiating education will be a large focus. We've got league organisation with some speeches and some open floor sessions with key people from around the UK. Coaching for coaches will be a large focus. We've got some big names coming for that too. We've got the WFTDA and MRDA will be represented, having a face-to-face session for both of those organisations, as well as a face-to-face potentially with the UKRDA directors too. So,
Now, I know a lot of people, especially within my league, are very interested in the idea of getting juniors involved. We've seen the growth of junior roller derby in the US, and we know that getting people into the sport at a younger age will improve the ability level available to us. Is there going to be anything there for the idea of junior derby?
Absolutely, yep. Yeah. We've got, I believe we've got a whole day of junior focused sessions. Some interesting people coming along to that one. Should be very good. We can't really give too much information away at this time. We're still nailing down the last little touches to the schedule, but all in good time.
Well, it's good to see that a lot of the areas are being covered that are going to be helping developing leagues and new leagues and very established leagues all at once, which is all going to be very, very beneficial for the sport. Now, when is this conference?
It's the 11th and 12th of October. That's Saturday and Sunday. We have accommodation available on the Friday, Saturday night. What you just said is exactly the part of it. It's a dialogue for the future of the sport in the UK. If you feel you have something to contribute to that dialogue, then you should be at this conference.
Where's the conference?
It's at Warwick University in Coventry.
Are tickets still available, and where can we get them?
Tickets are available from www.ukrock.org.uk. All ticket prices are available on there. Should get all of the information from the same site too.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much for your help, Gary. I hope the conference goes very smoothly and that you've been wonderfully informative. Thank you very much.
Cheers.
I believe we are going to be going back to adverts again. Some more messages from our sponsors. Okay, this is Captain Malice back here at the Men's European Cup. Joins me by Ballistic Whistle and Jukebox. We have obviously the bench manager and one of the main jammers we'll have for something that's come from early today. You had quite the outing early today, nice healthy score. How'd that go for you?
Yeah, it felt good actually. Like we were happy with our jammer rotation. We're mixing a few things up with the packs. So this was kind of like their first test in anger, and we were really happy with how they worked. I think as the tournament wears on, they're going to get a little bit more cohesion and be a little bit stronger, which is great.
Yeah, he pretty much said everything I wanted to say, but I think overall we performed really well. I was really happy with it, and I think that we just need to keep our focus and make sure that we play the way that we play.
Did you train anything different at all coming into this tournament, noticing there's maybe like maybe one or two games on the first day and two on the second, or anything to do try different tactically coming into this? I know your blocking as a team has just gotten much stronger over the years, so is there anything you tried special maybe?
I'll start first this one. I think that, well, the big change was our packs, like changing, kind of making them a bit more even. That helped a lot, and I think just training that in, and you know, I don't know, after doing a stateside tour of 8 games in 8 days, 3 games in 2 days just seems like a cakewalk, so it's not quite so bad.
Yeah, I think what she said, for me personally, like that American tour really beat my body up quite a bit, and so I'm starting to feel it a little bit now, so I'm trying out a different jamming style at the moment. She calls it apathetic jamming. But I don't know, I'm just seeing how it goes. We'll see how it works. I mean, I feel like I got through the Brummies game and didn't have anywhere near the kind of like pains that I would have if I had have jammed the old way. So yeah,
I'm just going back to the balanced lineups. Have you tried, did you take a imbalanced lineups where it was heavily on power lineups and bring it to more balanced rotation of blockers? Was that something you brought into SDRD?
Yeah, I think it wasn't so much about power lineups. I think our packs were just a little bit different in performance in terms of how successful they were. And switching that up really made it easier to see how well the jammers are actually performing versus before it was you know, you might think one jammer is doing really well, but it's just because that one pack is performing really well. So just balancing out our players a little bit more, I think now that they've, you know, they've come a long way, learned a lot, and they don't necessarily need to rely on each other as much, so we were able to split up some of our strongest players, put them in two different packs, and kind of like filter that information down to the other players, give them a little bit better positional sense.
Fantastic. Now, you're both Rydell-sponsored skaters, and I can see you're here with a lot of Rydell stuff off in the background, if you look over our shoulders. Now, obviously, being a Rydell-sponsored skater means you get a lot of access to Rydell merchandise, but the benefits that that gives you that really help you as a skater, does it help you give that information on to other people? And those two things benefit you and your league a lot more.
Yeah, I feel like I've been really lucky to have the opportunity to work for Rydell, and all of the access to the high-level gear has meant that I've been able to experiment a lot more with like different things. I mean, I try like different brands products as well, and it gives me like a much more rounded idea of like what works for me specifically. And so when I'm talking to people at the booth, I'm very much like, in my experience, this is what I think, and I let people like make their own kind of conclusions based on like how they are as skaters and whatnot.
Yeah, and for me, I've been a rink rat my whole life. I've skated on Rydell my whole life, so it was a pretty simple decision to go with them. I'm a big fan of them as a company, big fan of them in general, the way they do business, and their skates are really great.
Well, Rydell obviously are sponsoring the Men's European Cup this year, so they're helping out with making sure this all goes running smoothly. Bringing it back to the tournament at hand, you will be playing the winners of this game, which is Titan of Fear versus New World tomorrow. Any preference there at all from you?
You know what? I couldn't tell you. At watching this game, I'm like, we'll play whoever wins, you know. Like, I feel like both teams have really good strengths, and as the scoreboard shows at this point, it's impossible to separate them. So having to pick a team based on like how they're doing is impossible right now. I just, you know, we get along with all the guys on both of those teams, so whatever happens, it's gonna be fun.
I think if anything, just like we played New World Order earlier this year, and having that experience, you know, it doesn't hurt anything. Knowing the team a little bit more, Nanaki got a chance to play against them before and really had a great successful game. And it always helps when you kind of know what you're going to get a little bit. But yeah, I mean, they're really close, so I look forward to playing either of them.
Yeah. And finally, before the tournament, a lot of skaters were asked any specific skaters or teams they were watching out for. Now we're partway through the tournament, has it changed your opinion, or anyone else is sort of opening your eyes to new and interesting threats?
I was, like, before the tournament, I really thought Lincolnshire were going to be a force to be reckoned with. I know a lot of their skaters, like, from Team England, and they're exceptional skaters, exceptional players. Seeing the Sus team play against them, all of a sudden they are a real contender, because we played Sus, like, 3 months ago, maybe, and this is a different Sus. You know, they are a completely different team. They look really solid, really well drilled, really controlled. And I feel like they're maybe like a dark horse. I'd be really interested to see them come up against Toulouse tomorrow.
Yeah, that was my answer. But I was really impressed. It was impressive to see how much they got done in that amount of time versus the time we just played them. It was really good. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Jukebox. Yeah. And Ballistic. I wish you all the best luck in this tournament. And I am now going to be joined, if you want to just go away, gently go on, away with you.
Gary.
I'm now going to be joined by the head photographer of this European tournament, who's going to tell us a little bit about the photography side, the unsung heroes, but you always love them on Facebook. This is Gary. He is the head... Graham? Yeah. They told you it was Gary. They lied to me. I think it was that lovely Shalane woman. Okay, so this is Graham. He's the head photographer of the Men's European Cup. He's also the photographer here today. Now, photographers always around the track, but no one really understands the work that has to go into what you do. Tell me a little bit about what it's like to be just a roller derby photographer.
Well, it is a lot of hard work. I mean, obviously we've got to kind of spend the same amount of time in and around track, but afterwards as well, there's just so many hours of processing photographs and all this kind of thing. And wow, it looks like Seb's on his way as well. That's good news.
Yeah, that's always there being exiting the building with the ambulance for a big cheer. The skaters will be back warming up before we restart the second half, but back to Graham. Now, a lot of work goes into Atlas. Now, this time you're organizing how many photographers?
I think there's about 6 or 7 here today, but we had 10, maybe 11, 12 people actually wanting to come today to photograph. So it is quite a lot of effort to wrangle people, but they're all good people. They all They've done it before. They understand the deal. They know what they're doing. They behave.
Now, I, as a skater, at least for the following 24 hours after a bout, I'm just going, where are my photos? Yes. Not in a nasty way, but I just want to see if I just did something other than stand there bridging. Now, do you find that pressure environment to get the photos out is a hindrance to your walk or not?
Well, I want to get them out as well because I want my free time back. So I try to get them done at least over the weekend or like the first one or two weeknights, because I don't want to take it up the whole week. I want to get it done out of the way. But I'm a skater as well, so I know what it's like. And sometimes we have a practice on the Monday after the bout, and people see us there and they're like, what are you doing skating? Get home and get the photos processed. What are you doing?
They're not hitting you any harder if you don't get the photos.
No, it's usually fine.
Well, Graham, I'll let you get back to work.
Well, thank you.
Thank you very much for your hard work. I look forward to seeing all the photos. I hope you make me look wonderful. Have a good day. I think I'm handing over to Sven as he's sort of loitering behind me.
You can stand here. Basically, just a bit of an update. As you can probably hear in the background, there's a big cheer there. The skaters are now warming up. So we're going to have 10 minutes of warm-up time just to let the skaters get back into the stride. So after this, we're going to go to some short adverts. That is your cue to go get the kettle boiled, have a comfort break, and we will be back here in about 8 minutes from now, pick up the game where it left off. Remember, it was tied 72-72, so we've still got a nail biter finish, and you've got 25 minutes of play remaining. So go away when these adverts are playing, make a cup of tea, get yourself comfortable, ready for the remainder of period two.
Alright, we are back here live at the Men's European Cup, continuing the game between Tyne and Fear, Old Derby, New World Order. With 25 minutes left on the period clock, we have been stopped for quite some time due to an injury, but we are underway now. Dark Matter jamming for Tyne and Fear, picking up lead. It looks like Hugo Boss is on his way to the penalty box. Taking a tumble out of the front there, Dark Matter. Needs to recycle behind the player that blocks him out of bounds. And it looks like Tintin now back on the track. It was a very minimal power jam situation there. Dark Matter still with the advantage of lead jammer. Penalty box, I believe, is empty now.
Yeah, our view of the penalty box is being obscured at the moment. There is just Hugo Boss in the penalty box at the moment for New World Order.
All right, thanks, Sven. You're much taller than I am. Plus, you're standing up. That helps.
Dark Matter recycling Tintin. So Hugo Boss is going to join the pack. So we're back 4-4 blockers. Dark Matter slips inside Hugo Boss, outside the rest of the pack. Tintin just crashes through Chemical and Swiss Army Mike into the front of More Than a Woman and GIF, but out of play called, so they've got a release.
So Tyne and Fear extending the lead now, pushing through, coming up against John Gin Giovanni at the front there, calling it off Dark Matter as he exits the engagement zone, picking up 4 points in that last pass. Tyne Fear back in control of this game, 91 points on the board, 72 to New World Order, 23 and a half minutes of play left on the period clock.
Yeah, it's going to be a mental test now with both teams to see whether A, they can both take an hour and a quarter out of the middle of a game and come back fighting. But obviously New World Order now, that's Lieutenant Dam, who is sidelined. And now obviously Darth Sebius is missing from the lineup, who is one of the power blockers. So let's see what that does to New World Order, just in terms of their spirit. Are they going to come back fight harder for their fallen comrades, or will it affect them?
Well, Alien Al talking about fighting, he is certainly desperately trying to get through that inside line, but it's absolutely just completely stopped there off the line by Gay Fawkes, but he is through now. A very tightly rotating pack there coming through the outside from Tyne and Fear.
It looks as though Gay Fawkes actually in the middle, he went to put a big block into New World Order, ended up taking down Dog. So Dog, just from sitting there, calls off the jam, but still gets, looks like 4 points going up there for Tyne and Fear.
So we're seeing Bereft jamming for New World Order. I think it's the first time we've seen him don the jammer helmet cover today against 60 quad bit for Tyne and Fear in the black. Bereft, we have seen him blocking quite a bit today. Moo is He holds at the back of the pack quite well on his own when he's recycling the players. Still fighting for that back line. New World Order struggling to break through, but once they do, they know it's going to be all hands on deck getting him through.
Looks like we've got lead bereft, but 60 quad bits straight out behind him, so Jammer's racing around now. Is clear.
He's going to let him pass, pull it off. Didn't quite go how he was hoping. All right, we're going to be seeing Alien Al lining up against Dark Matter. Tyne and Fear playing in the black jerseys. New World Order playing in the white. New World Order now on 72 points. Tyne and Fear 95, 21 minutes of play left on the clock.
Got both lines of blockers have moved away from the jam line. So we're going to see which jammer is going to be able to exploit their blockers best. Barnabash and Tank just rolling around holding Alien Al behind. Looks like Dark Matter has been recycled, is coming back behind Smack Bauer.
We've seen a clockwise block penalty sending Barnabash to the penalty box, so it's going to be 4-on-3 taking down one of the blockers. Let's see how Tyne and Fear hold up those walls with somebody missing, not managing to pin him down. 5 points on the board for Alien Al. Does this mean that one player can make the difference by breaking up those walls with Tyne and Fear? This is the opportunity the New World Order are really looking to break through. Ooh, a tumble down.
Gay Fawkes picks up the low block right at the end of the jam there. Alien Al is obviously winded there, being helped with his feet by Hugo Boss.
He's all right, skating off.
Just some updated timings have been handed me. Obviously, these are going to be provisional depending on how long the remainder of this game plays out, but it looks like our next game, game 5, should be due to start around about 6:10, and then our last game today, game 6, will be at 10:08. Obviously, again, just a reminder to you watching globally, that is Greenwich Mean Time.
Thanks, Sven.
Back to the track, we've got Man-Shaped Dog lining up at Tyne and Fear against Tintin for New World Order. Barnabash standing in the bin, Gay Fawkes sitting in the bin. There's only two blockers on, but they've put Giff and Chemical on, so the two probably the best blockers to have in that undermanned lineup. Barnabash returns to bring some strength, but it looks like Dog has got the lead. Dog has lead, but Tintin is out in front.
Do you think he's going to be toying out with the New World Order jammer there?
I think Dog's going to run the clock on Gay Fawkes, who's standing in the bin now. So let's see if Dog can just hold it up. And we've got the Tyne and Fear blockers pushing that pack speed.
One of the fastest packs I think we've seen so far today, actually. We've seen a lot of slow packs throughout the tournament so far.
As we thought, as soon as Gay Fawkes returns the track, Dog just calls it off. So that's empty bin again for the next lineup of Alien Al going to go up against 60 quad bit.
Full force on the track for both teams. Points as they stand. New World Order on 80. Tyne and Fear 95. So 15 point differential as it stands at the minute. Looks like we've seen a start from the pivot line. I think they're coming back in fashion.
The amusing thing is when you see a pivot line start with players who don't really remember them and get caught out with a pivot trap where the pivot just puts the foot on the line at the last minute.
Yeah, back in the day, in the May 2010 rule set. Alien Al taking a tumble there from earlier. Is he recycling back? He does look like he's had a little bit of wind knocked out of him, so he's going to come back on, regroup. He's coming up against a wall that's facing off with Porky from the Power of Scotland, no less. I think he's pretty glad that that got called off when it did. Didn't look like he was looking forward to hitting that wall.
Sorry, it looks like the jam ref has just gone across to check on Alien Al. I think they were looking if the referees see any blood on the players, they call the jam straight away. And yes, it looks like we've got one of the medics. Just going to go around and check him out. He took a bit of a big hit in that previous jam. And then obviously in this one, again, he took a bit of a tumble and
took a while getting up, so just precaution, we'll just go and check them. Still an empty bin, so we are 4-4 on the track. Tintin line up against Dark Matter. Dark Matter slides to the inside, but Tintin beats Gif and Moo. Pick up lead for New World Order. Dark Matter being pushed to the outside, being recycled back by Hugo Boss and Smack Bauer. Tintin picks up the lap point and is already on his first scoring pass. Chemical recycling now.
Little bit of contact off the track there, but I think it was completely accidental. Dark Matter should have been off making his way to the penalty box. He is there's a cut track penalty there, so a power jam situation for New World Order. Tintin had a really strong start to this jam, but now he's facing off against Moo at the back of the pack, and he's not making it easy for him at all. He managed to exploit a few of the small gaps that he managed to find on the outside line, but they're not there anymore. I think the evolution of Time and Fear is one of the things that they do, is they notice these things and they regroup very, very quickly to try and cover.
Moo picks up the failure to return, getting called out to play at the back and just taking that extra beat to try and...
And we've got 4J reanimated GIF going off for a clockwise block. So we're going to be seeing very minimal force on track for Time and Fear.
Star pass to bereft as Dark Matter comes out the bin. So we've got a jammer swap. It's going to go 2 minutes now because obviously we've lost lead jammer.
35 seconds left on the jam clock. Very nice. Just stepping around on the inside, picking up 4 points. Sorry. A cut track penalty now being
called. That's Hugo Boss for the cut track.
Hugo Boss on his way to the penalty box as Moo powers out into the back of the pack with Bob on. Reanimated GIF now rejoining the pack. A no pass, no point. Hand signal there from Lotta Clockwork.
I think that was Chemical picked up a skating out of bounds. So bereft, we've just seen him start jamming in this period, but it was that star pass from Tintin that gave him the first points he's racked up, so let's see if they'll be using him as a jammer more. Just as an aside, when we had that bit stoppage, someone had given Lieutenant Dam one of the wheelchairs that they use for the wheelchair rugby and the wheelchair basketball with all the roll cage and things
on it,
and he's convinced he should be allowed on to jam now, so...
More wheels! Life on wheels is fun, but sometimes it goes wrong.
Speaking of wheels, let's just give a quick shout out to Juice Wheels. Finally, a refreshing innovation in wheels developed specifically for derby at all levels of play. The new technology delivers grip when you need grip, roll when you need roll, and energy when you need it most. And remember, they will be giving a full set of, I believe, the Juice Martini wheels are being given to all of our three all tournament best players this weekend. So again, if you're on the Twitter hashtag MEC2014, just give us your shout out. Who do you think so far today from the games you've seen is worthy of recognition of best jammer, best blocker, most valuable player?
Absolutely. I did manage to have a look at the martini wheels on the stand earlier on, and they look pretty swish. They've even got a little martini glass on the actual lines on the wheels. So alright, so we're going to be seeing Crash Mat jamming for the first time for New World Order up against Dog for Time and Fear. Crash Mat now bouldering into the back of Gay Forks as Dog has called off for a back block penalty. Takes a tumble on his way to the box. He's not going to be happy about that. Crash Mat is taken down on the outside by Barnabas, and it's an out of play block sending him through, which leaves Crash Mat to pick up lead jammer for New World Order.
And we've just got Tank and Gay Fawkes in fact. No, Gay Fawkes is now being sent off. So just Tank, only blocker on track for Tyne and Fear until Chemical's going to come back. So 2-on-3 pack advantage, in the 2-on-4 pack advantage to, I should say 4-on-2, to New World Order. Crash Mat just being sent across the apex on one knee by Chemical. New World Order trying to push Tank forward to try and control this pack a bit more. Hugo Boss clears a bit of Tank out of the way of the track. Crash Mat, Al just being let himself be pushed forward as Dog comes back to track, stuck behind Don Giovanni.
Advantage dropping 4-on-3. In fact, 3-on-3 as we see Hugo Boss now. Picking up the penalty.
5-point pick up there for New Wheeled Order. Dog is on his way back to the penalty box for a track cut. New Wheeled Order now only 3 points behind the Tyne and Fear lead. 101 to 104. Could this be the jam that decides it? We've got 30 seconds left on the penalty clock, period clock. Sorry, on the jam clock. We had quite a long break.
Yeah, we've got a long time left on the
14 minutes on the period clock.
You made me panic there. But have I been really standing here talking for 25 minutes and not remembered?
No. 3 more points on the board. A star pass is issued down to Scooby Zoom. Now he's got that on top of the helmet cover.
We've got a clear bin as Dog comes back to track, but that ends the jam. So we're going to start full lineups for the next jam.
All right, so Crashmack, we believe, picked up 15 points in that last pass. Scooby Zoom, in that last jam, Scooby Zoom picked up 3. So 18 in that last jam. Scores stand 104 apiece with 13 minutes left on the period clock.
We're just
got an official timeout being called. Sven? Just trying to work out what is happening before we get started. We're having a look at the scores, I think. You can hear the cheering from the in-house announcers for the home league, Tyne and Fear. And New Wheeled Order fans, they go certainly in fine voice this afternoon. I think it just leaves us a little bit of time to mention some of our sponsors. Onwi Skate Gear. Onwi is a new concept of protective gear specifically designed for alternative sports and non-motorized wheeled sports. Designed and run by skaters, our aim is to create protective gear that we would wear ourselves, products that keep us safe and protect our bodies against all sorts of injuries, while at the same time being unobtrusive and comfortable. Visit onwebrand.com.
And if you pay careful attention in the next game when Lincolnshire are playing, you'll see some of that gear on, I believe, Kosh and Eves or Omoy.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, right, Alien 64-bit jamming for Tyne and Fear in the box for a cut track. So lead for Alien Owl.
Very significant point in time, because we're going to be seeing once a pass is made here, we're going to be seeing New Wheeled Order retaking the leads. Lead Jammo, 5-point pass on the board, taking them up to 109 points. Tyne and Fear still on 104. Now that 60 quad bits back on the track, he's going to be looking to even things up a little bit. He's trying to exploit that gap through the solid white wall through the back of the pack there. Not making it easy for him at all. He's down on the inside, making him recycle back as far as he can as Alien Al comes back. And we've got Slam Cinesit now on his way to the penalty box. Another 5-point pass on the board for New Wheeled Order.
I made this 19 so far. Correct me if my mathematics is wrong.
You got a thumbs up there from Roller Polar Bear.
Right, so it looks as though for the next lineup, I think it's just Slamsy Nesbit in the box. That was a big jam for New Wheeled Order.
So Tyne and Fear still sitting on 104. New Wheeled Order now on 118. Just over 11 and a half minutes left to play on the period clock. I'll get my clocks right this time, Sven. We're seeing Crash Mart lining up against Dark Matter, two of the mats. Mean looking back walls. This is not going to be an easy one game, whoever takes the lead. And at this point in time, I don't think we've got any inkling of how it's going to go. But Dark Matter is out in front for lead jammer for Tyne and Fear. Slamsy Nesbit now comes back on track.
Crash Mad star pass to Scooby Zoom, who's now out after his initial pass. Dark Matter on his first one just knocks Hugo Boss to the floor. Look at the smile on his face after that hit.
Hugo Boss is not a guy that's easy to get off of his feet. So Dark Matter's pleased with himself for that one, getting the crowd riled up, getting some cheering going.
Just off camera there, Hugo Boss actually took time out to go and double high five Dark Matter for that hit.
He was like, kudos, bro.
You think Hugo Boss is the kind of fella that says bro?
I just come out with rubbish half the time, so yeah. All right, so we've seen Dog lining up against Tintin. Dog powering through towards the front of the pack there, coming up against Slam C Nesbit, who is not letting up at all at the front of the pack there.
Just Tintin being held up behind Giff and Al. Dog just looks like he's complaining there a bit theatrically about some potential high blocks that he's trying to get through there.
Really? Theatrics?
But Dog's on his first scoring pass now. Tintin recycled all the way back behind Moo. Takes him the full 20. No pack called. Donjin Giovanni smacked Bauer now at the front. Just trying to hold up Dog.
It's bridging almost like too far. Called out of play warning there on the inside by Schreff.
Tintin finally slips through. But gets the... Looks like he's picked up a cut track. So power jam. Tying in fear as Dog is on another scoring pass now. Slides past bereft. Big pile up at the front as Dog falls and gets rolled over by Donjin Giovanni and Slam C Nesbit. Throws Donjin Giovanni down. Slam C Nesbit holds him up. Smack Bauer goes in, but has to release for 5 points. Manship Dog for Tyne and Fear.
Oh my goodness! He calls it off! 1 point behind New World Order's lead. So it's 118 to Tyne and Fear, 119 to New World Order. Just shy of 9 minutes left on the period clock. My goodness, this is going to be tight to the end. 60 quad bits, 11th jam. Thanks, Roller Polar Bear.
Yeah, you'll very rarely see 60 quad bit in a blocking lineup because he is one of the heavy rotation jammers for Tyne and Fear.
I think he certainly thrives in a jamming position.
He doesn't have the build of a blocker, but I've seen he's very agile on his feet and he does block quite often when they're... like, you know, when the lineups are getting tighter, if they have got a big lead and they're rotating in other jammers. He's just got Hugo Boss and Sausage Roller at the front and he's just forcing them. He's looking for the out of play call.
He's pushing back. They're bridging. There it is. He's out in front. The lead for Tyne and Fear. Thumbs up to the bench as he comes past. He's happy with that.
That's allowed Tintin, though, to come out the bench. So Tintin's on his initial pass. Scooby Zoom just throws 60 quad bit to the inside. He keeps 1 foot out of bounds though, so he's not going to get the cut. Managed to recycle back. Gay Fox is trying to do a bit of work keeping Scooby Zoom off his back. Donjin Giovanni now doing some great, I think, is that the hockey honey shuffle in front of 60 quad bit.
Ooh, great hit from Moo up at the front there. Scooby Zoom's cane off at the front eight.
Star pass again.
No pass, no penalty. Called off before Scooby Zoom manages to put any more points on the board.
60 quad bit, took a big hit, just landed on his back in the outfield there and called it off, just realising he was never going to get back to his feet in time before they scored.
Tyne and Fear now retaking the lead by 2 points. They're on 121. New World Order trailing by 109, trailing on 119, not by 119, just by 2 points.
And for you fact fans, there's been 3 star passes by New World Order and all 3 have gone to Scooby Zoom.
Oh yeah. Alright, Alien Al now blocking for jamming for New World Order up against Dark Matter for Tyne and Fear. Dark Matter is out in front, picking up leads.
Bob Om with a shove out of Alien Al. Chemical is recycling him back, so Bob Om gets back on in position. They've got the 4-wall blocking again against Alien Al.
All the Al's coming up also against reanimated Giff there in turn 2. And he's bouncing off them, but he is pushing them forward. He's very, very good at getting them to move, even though they're blocking him. Looks like Slam C Nesbit's going to be taking another seat in the penalty box.
Dark Matter, and he gets the 4 points for that grand slam pass because he did actually pass Slam C Nesbit on his knees, which isn't a scoring pass.
Reanimated Giff now sitting in the penalty box as well.
Alien Al just fighting against Bob Om at the front. Alien Al not got the jammer star on at the moment, but he has got it in his hand, so he's the jammer, just not active until that star goes back on the helmet. Dark Matter with the 5 points, just coasting round here.
looks like he's just taking his time, watching the action. Pack's catching up with him now. He needs to make a move or do something. There you go, he's calling it off.
He timed that to the second when Giff got released from the bin.
Very nicely done. He was watching carefully. Not too concerned about what else was happening on track. I think he was aware of the fact that they now have the 11-point lead.
It looks like we've got, a team timeout, new wheeled order here, so let's get the teams a minute to compose themselves, catch your breath. And we'll take a minute to just give you a shout about Double Threat Skates, the roller derby skate shop based in central London, run by London Roller Girls Kristen Lee and Gorgasm. Check them out at www.doublethreatskates.co.uk. They were going to have a stall here this weekend, but unfortunately couldn't make it, so we didn't get to catch up with them in person. But you should just go down and see them in person. They're located just behind King's Cross Station, I believe. So if you're passing through the capital,
perfectly handy.
Go for a run.
But don't forget, you can check in with lots of our different sponsors online today. Do please give us a shout out on Twitter using the hashtag MEC2014. And when we receive your tweets, we should be able to give you a shout out.
So the timeout comes to its official end. Looks like we're going to have Don Gingivani jamming for New Yield Order now.
Just over 5 minutes left. 5 minutes and 20 seconds, if you can see that on your screens, left on the period clock. We are very nearly ready to go in the next jam. Don Gingivani lining up against Dog on the jam line. A lot of tussling through that back line. These walls are incredible today. New Wheeled Order have an amazing strength in the walls.
Hugo Boss picks up the multiplayer block. It looks like there's another multiplayer block as well going to come out of here. Glenn Morangri trying to signal. It looks like there's more than a woman for Titan and Fear. So two multiplayer blocks with those tight, tight walls.
I wonder how many he's got on the board now. Hugo Boss has been in that penalty box quite a few times in the remainder of this period since we restarted play.
So Dog just looks behind him there, middle of the pack, sees Don Gingivani, comes around, calls the jam before Don Gingivani can pick up any points. Dog picked up three there, so pushes that lead out a little bit more. But as we've seen from this game time and time, in fact we've seen all day, just because you've got a bit of a lead at one moment doesn't mean you're going to keep it by the end of the game.
Absolutely. I mean, there's just over 4 minutes left, but you know that in that time this could easily change because we've seen it split second change in here.
Looks like we've got another new Lorda jammer with Smack Bauer taking the jamming role. So yeah, I'm guessing they're suffering some fatigue in their jammer rotation.
Mm-hmm. I've been really impressed with this blocking today as well.
They've lost Lieutenant Dan, which is one of the strong jammers, so obviously the rest of New Wheeled Order are picking up that huge deficit of jamming power.
Swiss Army Mike and Giff there doing a cracking job holding them back. Swiss Army Mike, we primarily see a lot of jamming from him. Very strong in both capacities, and I think he's really showing that off now. He's doing much better with the team. I think when he originally started skating with them, he's really gelling a lot better with the other skaters and very aware of what's going on around him.
So we've got 60 quarter bit on lead. Smack Bauer just being pushed out. Swiss Army Mike picks up the clockwise block. This, he's going to go to the bin for that last hit he made on Smack Bauer. Smack Bauer here still trying to get through his initial pass, and that's a complete crash. Matt just knocks 60 quarter bit out and recycles back a few feet as far as he can. Smack Bauer now coming up for his first scoring pass. The 60 quad bit is in the middle of his.
60 quad bit has picked up lead, but he's not calling it off. I think he wants to make sure that he's pushing through for those extra points.
He's got a tight wall there. Hugo Boss, Don Gingivani, and Sausage Roller just holding him up.
Is he going to call it from the outside, or is he going to recycle and try again?
Chemical with a lovely move, knocks Smack Bauer to the inside and recycles the length of the pack and the engagement zone right to the back, bridged out by Swiss.
Chemical has a very good awareness of the 20 feet mark, and that's something that has improved greatly over the past 12 months. He's very aware of those lines. Four more points in that last pass on the board for New Wheeled Order. Where does that leave us points-wise? 123 to New Wheeled Order, 141 to Tyne and Fear. Just shy of 2 minutes left on the period clock.
And you can't see this, but 60 quad bit has just collapsed in the Tyne and Fear bench area. I've never seen a man breathe so hard.
Well, not like seriously medically.
No,
comatose.
No, tired.
All right, Alien Al now jamming for New Wheeled Order. Dark Matter ahead of, he's very near the front of the pack there, but being recycled towards the rear. Sausage Roller doing a cracking job recycling him back there. New Wheeled Order now potentially having the advantage there. Not quite, it's being recycled as well as we see Gay Fawkes making his way to the penalty box.
Dark Matter starts his assault. He gets nudged to the side by Slamsy Nesbitt. Ducks underneath. He's got Hugo Boss and Scooby Zoom back in front as Alien Al gets pushed it off track by M1A1. Looks like Tank is picking up a low block for that hit he put on Alien Al. Dark Matter's just pushing Slamsy Nesbitt as far as he can. Slamsy Nesbitt picks up the forearms. It looked like it's probably 3 second contact rule.
Tank's game so far has been pretty clean. I don't think we've seen him in the penalty box an awful lot. Dark Matter riding the rope on the outside there, but actually going out of bounds, so he doesn't seem too pleased about having to recycle, but he knows he's got to do it. And it looks like we're going to be seeing another star pass for New Wheeled Order. Scooby Zoom, that's the fourth. Scooby Zoom, he seems like he's loving it. Oh, nice little apex jump on the inside there. Fantastic. Coming through, picking up 4 points. Jammer on jammer action as we come in through now.
It looks as though Alien Al is just sitting off at the side of the track in the crowd. Just before he made that star pass, we've got a timeout, New Wheeled Order.
It means we're going to be running into one more jam before the game finishes. Scores as they stand, Tyne and Fear on 146, New Wheeled Order on 127. Let's see how Tyne and Fear handle this last jam, being currently ahead.
We're just going to have a little bit of a delay again here. We've got Alien Al just off at the side. I think he's, it looks like possibly another leg stroke ankle thing. When he went off, he was, I'm just trying to see the medics at the moment. Look, he's just sitting on the side. I think the medics are just checking him over quickly.
Alright, so we've got just another 15 seconds left from the team timeout. They will be getting the last jam of this game underway. This has been absolutely amazingly close all the way through. And we had a differential of 20 or 30 points at one point during the first period. That got narrowed back down very quickly. And now we're starting to see it inch forward again in favour of Tyne and Fear. Let's see if they can hang on to that for the next 2 minutes. Cherry Fury is just standing on track having a chat to Dog at the back there, making sure everything's all right. So it looks like we're going to be seeing Dog taking the jammer line for Tyne and Fear against Bereft for New Wheeled Order. A couple of times we've seen Bereft jamming now in this game. Let's see how this plays out in the very last jam. And this is game 4 of the Men's European Cup. Do please get in touch with us via Twitter using the hashtag MEC2014. Let us know what you think of the game so far.
Just so you know, the jam timer, when that time out went in, the jam timer had stopped his clock on 20 hundredths of a second remaining in the period.
Wow.
So that was a well-timed timeout. If you want one more jam, that's a well-timed timeout.
Yeah, that, if that had been called a little bit later, they definitely wouldn't have been able to.
That just shows you, even when it's the last seconds of the game, when you're a ref or an NSO, you've got to be switched on right to the very end, because right at the end, you've just got to look up and see if someone's trying to call your attention, trying to get that timeout in.
Mm-hmm. You can't take anything for granted in roller derby, because, you know, everything counts up until the fourth whistle. in a jam. You know, it's that point at which when you're learning to jam, you never stop until you've heard that fourth whistle. You never sort of give up. Once you've heard the first one, that can be the difference between 1 or 4 points, 5 points in some cases. So let's see, we're into an official timeout just now. So you can hear the crowd going wild. We've got yours truly and Captain Malice on the in-house announcing, getting everybody going. Myself, Panda, and Sven will I be famous here on the in-house, on the feed for today.
Looks like Alien Al is back up to his feet now. The medics have helped me up, so he's going to just compose himself and they'll take him off just to check the light bulbs as it is.
Yeah, well, he's still got his skates on. So he's either hurting an awful lot or he's feeling not too bad.
He's had quite a few big hits today, Alien Al. So he's jammed well because of it. So
last jam, we've got Bereft against Man-Shaped Dog. Bereft fighting up against Reanimated Gif and Chemical at the back there. Moo and Relentless at the back, not letting through whatsoever.
Reanimated Gif just keeping him and throwing off. Dog gets lead, calls it immediately. That is game. Win Tyne and Fear. So Tyne and Fear will advance to play Sudden Discomfort tomorrow at 11 o'clock. A New Wheeled Order will go on to play the Crash Test Brummies. And that will be our last game of today. So they will take on the Crash Test Brummies in about an hour and a half, 2 hours. Let me check the time. Yeah, about an hour and a half. We'll see the Crash Test Brummies take on New Wheeled Order.
So the game we're going to be seeing on the track next is going to be Lincolnshire Rolling Thunder versus Pan Am Squad. The updated timings for that, Sven? So we're going to be running, I think you said, about 10 past 7?
Yeah, I think, the next game should be, 10 past, no, it should be starting, it'll probably be about 10 minutes from now, because the teams need to have a warm-up. So once we get these laps sorted out, we'll give the teams, Lincolnshire and Pan Am, we'll give them a chance to warm up, and then we'll get the game straight on. And then we'll reassess the times after that, but we should be aiming for the... someone's taking me timing sheet.
I think it was that naughty little bulldog.
We will keep you appraised of the timing change as long as you stay tuned to the Men's European Cup 2014.
Absolutely. Thank you very much for your patience today, folks. We'll try and keep you updated with how we're doing with Darth Sebius. But for now, we're going to hand over to some adverts, and then we'll be moving into Game 5.